Well, imagine disliking Australia so much that you're willing to risk your life by mailing yourself back home to the UK in a wooden crate. So we're talking about 90 centimetres by 60 centimetres. You're right in there?
Well, look, in May 1965, Brian Robson did exactly that, and he almost died in the process. Brian joins us now from Cardiff in Wales. Brian, you couldn't have hated Australia that much. I was in there for about 10 seconds.
Good morning, guys. I did, and I was in there for 5 days, but...
Why?
But you've got to go back, fellas, to 1964-65 Australia. And believe me, if you were in a family, you were well off. It was great. If you were a single teen, you know, I lived in Melbourne and the pubs closed at 6 o'clock. There was no way to meet people. You could walk down the main streets in Melbourne. And quite honestly, after about 7 o'clock, you wouldn't see another soul. And so it just became boring, monotonous, lonely, and I missed home, quite honestly.
I think there'll be a lot of Melburnians who aren't happy with you saying that Wales is more exciting than Melbourne. Tell us how you hatched this plan. Well, yeah. It's kind of genius and kind of mad as well.
Oh, it's definitely mad, and I wouldn't advise anybody to do it now. But... My friends, Paul and I, we all worked for the... Paul, John and I, should say, all worked for the Victorian Railways. And one day we went to an exhibition, I believe, in somewhere in Melbourne, and it was a British Expo-type thing. And there was a company there called Pickford's, and they had a big sign up, "We can move anything, anywhere." And I remember saying to my friends, well, perhaps they could move us. We all laughed about it. And then I went home, they went home, and I couldn't sleep all night. I just thought, there's got to be something in this. I can do it. I can do it. And the next day I told them I was actually going to post myself to the UK. And Paul, actually, being the joker of the bunch, he said, well, hang on a minute. Look, I'll go out and get some postage stamps and you might catch the next post. It was that sort of thing. That's how it started.
You'll never find an Irishman to dissuade you from a genius idea like that. How tall were you? Because I'm 5'11". You got in here with a whole bunch of stuff as well, huh?
Yeah,
what did you take in the crate with you?
I took a suitcase. I took two glass bottles, one pint of water, one empty bottle for obvious reasons, a torch and a hammer.
Who's this boyo in the picture we're looking at here?
That's one of the guys that actually discovered me in Los Angeles. I don't know his name. I've never actually met him, but I watched him do a backward somersault when he realised there was something in the crate.
Oh, I can only imagine. So tell us about the actual journey from Melbourne to Wales. It was all running pretty smoothly until the plane was diverted to the US.
Well, it wasn't diverted, actually. What it was, we booked it with Qantas and we flew... from Melbourne, I flew from Melbourne to Sydney with Ansett ANA in the crate. The crate was left on the run, on the tarmac for about 22 hours, and I was upside down. That was rather uncomfortable, to say the least. And then, because the Qantas flight was full, they put it onto a Pan American flight. But I didn't know this, you see. And it was a Pan American freighter that went, it stopped at every runway till it got to the Pacific, flew over there, and landed eventually in Los Angeles. And I thought I was in London. I didn't realise I was in Los Angeles, but I was in too bad a condition, really, to bother too much at that time.
Oh, Brian, all said and done, how many hours were you in that crate for?
The whole journey took about 5 days, from the time I started it in Melbourne to the time I was discovered in Los Angeles. It was about 5 days.
And you were slipping in and out of consciousness, weren't you?
Oh, the whole time, yeah, the whole time. Probably from, I would say, after the first 3 or 4 hours, perhaps even, you know. And, of course, lack of oxygen, hypothermia. 1 minute I was boiling, the next I was freezing because, you know, jets in those days were few and far between and they didn't have any pressurization or heating in the holds and stuff like that. So it was a very uncomfortable journey.
I'd well imagine. What had you considered and what had you not considered when you came up with this plan? I mean, because there was obviously a strong possibility that you wouldn't have made it, let alone made it to Wales. Did you consider losing your life at any time?
No, we didn't consider anything, quite honestly. It was just a brilliant idea. Oh, that's what we thought, or I thought. And the idea was just to get home. And there was very little consideration given to any of it. I mean, the first time I started considering things was at Sydney Airport when I was upside down, standing and laying on my neck.
Oh, yeah.
And then I thought it was a bad idea, but I was still going ahead with it.
Brian, this is the most extraordinary story. I'm surprised that Hollywood hasn't come knocking and, Tom Hanks isn't playing you. You've got a book coming out on your incredible experience as well.
I have. The book is actually online at the moment. There's the book there, look. And it's actually online now. It's released officially at the end of the month, but you can order it on pre-sale. As for the movie, I don't know about Tom Hanks. He's a little bit old, and he has starred in everything else. But there is a movie under production, and there's also a documentary for the cable networks. So it's taken off quite big now, actually.
Well, that's awesome. Well, I guess Tom Cruise is about your height, so maybe we can work something out. Australia wasn't all that bad, though. You managed to meet a couple of friends, and I believe you want to wish a young Australian friend a happy birthday today.
I do. I'd like, actually, to break some news to you, because you may remember that we were actually looking for my two assistants, co-conspirators, whatever, and they were John and Paul. Well, we found Paul, and this is the first time I've actually told anybody on any station.
Wow.
But we found him, and he is now a very old grandfather, and his youngest grandson, Logan, is actually a supporter and a fan of mine. And so I'd like to wish him a very happy 14th birthday for today, and to tell him that there's a free book which is signed by me on his way to him as we speak.
Oh, that is amazing.
Hopefully he doesn't pick up any ideas, though, Brian, because you'll be in trouble if he starts mailing himself halfway across the world.
I would indeed.
You can head to Amazon to grab Brian's book, The Great Escape. What a title. Brian, thanks for making our day. It's such a good story. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me on the program. Thank you.
All the best.
We're back in a moment with all the news and more. You're going to get back in your box?
Bye.
See you after the break.
Take me to the couch.